Blessed is the name of the living God. Hallelujah. Shout to the Lord. Everybody shout. Everybody shout. Oh. Shout to the Lord. Everybody shout. Everybody shout. Oh, shout to the Lord. Shout the shout of praise. Shout to the Lord. Shout the shout of praise. Shout to the Lord. Shout the shout of praise. Hallelujah. Shout to the Lord. Everybody shout. Everybody shout. Come now. Shout to the Lord. Everybody shout. Everybody shout. Oh, shout the shout of praise. Everybody shout. Everybody shout now. Shout to the Lord. Come and shout to the Lord. Hallelujah. Shout to the Lord. 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 Hallelujah. Shout to the Lord. Shout to the Lord. There must be, I don't know, there must be, well, there's clearly more than 100 verses of scripture here that say something similar to this. Let them shout for joy and be glad that favor my righteous cause. This is the Lord talking. If you favor the Lord's righteous cause, hallelujah. Let me say that again. Let them shout for joy and be glad that favor my righteous cause. I mean, when you think about his righteous cause, that all men should be saved, that all men should come to the knowledge of the truth, that there should be peace on earth and goodwill towards men, that this whole earth should be filled with his glory. That there would only be righteousness and truth in the hearts of men. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. E brasso. Make on the mind. Now I take the Bible seriously. The Lord didn't say, let them just bow down and pray, or let them just give a sweet song of thanksgiving. He said, shout. Now, in case somebody doesn't understand what shout means, because there's some people may not understand what a word like shout means. Shout's where you, with all your voice, begin to yell, but it isn't a yell. It's the strongest voice that you can muster. That's a shout. Huh? That's a shout. I mean, that's a holler. A holler is the strongest voice you can give. Somebody said, no, you got to holler. You got to holler louder. Blind Bartimaeus, he was hollering. And they said, be quiet. He hollered louder. Huh? So I say that the shout is when he started hollering louder. Ha, 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 ha. Now. Establish the point. The Lord said, go march around Jericho and then begin to lift up your voice and shout. 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 Now, you can imagine what shout was like in that instance, because they were shouting for their lives. Huh? They got the folks up there on the top of the wall
doing military exercises so that Israel began to get afraid because they were showing them what they were getting ready to get a taste of. They're doing military exercises, and here's the Israelites walking around. And all they're bearing up is something that represents the glory of God. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, the Ark of the Covenant represented the glory of God, but it had no power compared to the name of Jesus. It had no power in the earth compared to the name of Jesus, for God has purposed that all power and authority be in that name. Hallelujah. Father gave him a name. Father gave him a name. Father gave him a name that is above every name, that at his name everything would bow in heaven and earth, everything in the earth and under the earth. He put him above all principality, power, and might and dominion. He's given him a name that is above every name in this world and also in the world to come, that it by his name every knee should bow, every tongue should confess. So all authority is vested in his name. Now, somebody said, well, I don't understand why we should shout. Well, what happens is that as you begin to get to know the Lord, you discover that he loves love. And he loves passionate displays of love. And I guarantee you, you want him to show some passionate displays of love towards you. I guarantee it. And when he does, you're going to find yourself sitting in the most blessed place you ever thought imaginable. I'm telling you, when Papa gets going and he gets to shouting and he gets to singing, rejoicing over you, Zephaniah 3:17. Listen to me. Christ Jesus has power over the spirit of affliction. I break that power off of you right now. Men will lie and they'll cheat and they'll steal and they'll say all kinds of strange things against God and try to hinder what God would do. But I'm going to tell you right now, in the name of Jesus Christ. Tonight, Manny, God's going to touch you. Christ Jesus is going to touch you. Doesn't matter who's told you that his name's not powerful. Tonight, I'm proved to you. I'm more powerful. I'm more powerful as his representative than any man on the face of the earth as the representative of man or as the representative of the powers of darkness. No matter what form they come in, I'm more powerful because Jesus vested me with the power. Hallelujah. 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 Somebody said, well, that's bragging. Yeah, but I'm bragging on Jesus. I'm bragging on what God did for me at Calvary. I'm not bragging on anything that I have within myself. I'm bragging on the fact that he's given to us these things, and I believe it, and I'm making my boast in him, and I'm honoring him by calling him truthful. I'm honoring him by upholding his word, saying what he said is a reality, and that he himself would stand in proof of everything that he's testified of. I'm here to declare to you that it's easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for one little word that he spoke to fail. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Woo-hoo.
Can I brag on Jesus for a little bit?
Yeah, you brag.
I have to brag on Jesus for a little bit. I'll tell you what, he's my Savior. He's my best friend. He's my comforter. When all others forsake, he's there. He's righteous. He's faithful and he's true. More faithful than a brother. Hey, listen. Listen, here's the story. We go from glory to glory.
Yes, we do.
Everything besides Christ is just transitory. He was battered and bruised, all torn up and gory. It's what it took to prove that he was eternally for me. It was for my sins that he bled. They crushed thorns on his head. There's a wound in the side where the spear went in once he was dead. The water and the blood gushed out, still speaking the resurrection. Everlasting love that won't weaken. Hallelujah. The love of God. Oh, the love of God. I just have to brag on my Jesus. I love my Jesus. I love my Jesus. He's so good. He's so good.
Hallelujah.
He's so good.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When you have something you're proud of, you brag about it. And you're not ashamed to brag about it. You tell anybody.
That's right.
And I'm going to step this up in my life. God's been speaking this to me. And I'll encourage you. Just go brag on Jesus. Just go brag on him. Tell what he's done for you. There's no more powerful story than to tell what God, Christ Jesus, has done for you. What an amazing Savior. What an amazing God. Hallelujah. I love you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Woo-hoo. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, there is absolutely no weapon formed against you that will be able to prosper. Let me ask you, help you understand, the enemy may come at you one way, but he'll flee seven. If he comes at you, in other words, 10 different ways, he flees 70 different ways. Hallelujah. No matter how he comes, there's absolutely no way that the powers of the enemy can stop you, slow you down, change God's word. If they try to touch your body with physical affliction, I'm telling you right now, the power of the word and the authority of his name will absolutely annihilate every sickness and disease. If the powers of darkness try to come and touch you in your realms of your spirit, and to touch you in your realms of your love life towards the Father, here's what Papa's going to do. He's going to come right to your defense and say, my hand shall find all my enemies. My right hand shall search the mountain and destroy them. God will uphold you and keep you. He said, He that started you shall finish you. He that began a good work shall finish that work. Hallelujah. He's the author. He is the completer. He's the finisher. You can trust him on the way from here throughout eternity. He'll never change. He won't change. You can be comfortable. When you step over into the realms of glory, let's say tonight that you should leave this life, this body, and step over into that realm where all of a sudden everything about this realm is so, even in the height of your joy, your love, it pales to compare to that which is there. Listen to this. You can be confident of this one thing, that after 10 trillion years with being with him, he's not going to change his mind and kick you out. You can be comfortable every day for all eternity to knowing that he is on your side. He will uphold you and keep you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's why the Lord says, let them shout for joy and be glad that favor my righteous cause. Let them say continually, the Lord be magnified, which hath pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. Hallelujah. People want to say that we have false doctrine because we believe in the prosperity of his servants, that we're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, that he has committed to us all the riches of his glory. Well, that's just their fault. That's their loss, because you can't ever persecute somebody for being blessed and ever expect to be blessed yourself. My heart goes out to such a disposition. But I'm telling you right now, I am determined with all that is within me to see God's people step into this habitation in him. You can be seated. Praise God. Pray just a little bit more. You don't have to play the whole time if you don't want to, Emily. You can if you want, but just going to have you play just a little bit. Because I don't know. I haven't played because I don't know that I'm done singing. I don't know that I'm done worshiping. When the atmosphere is right, I worship all night. What do you mean then the atmosphere is right? When I don't feel anything opposing the anointing, you see. When I don't feel things out of sorts and wrong, because God, the Holy Ghost, is going to stop this flow to go and reach out to you because he loves you. He wants to bring you along. Father's not going to leave anybody behind. He doesn't just take the sheep and say, come on, let's just go on to heaven. Forget about those few over there. They all upset. They sick. They got a stomach ache. And they can't keep up. He doesn't do that. He just slows everybody down, goes over there and says, starts taking care of the sheep. Healing the sheep. Hallelujah. Praise God. Those are shepherds after his own heart. Hallelujah. I'm so glad that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. Blessed is the name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, oh praise ye the Lord, hallelujah, hallelujah, oh praise ye the Lord. I want you to know that Father is on your side. You know, we've been dealing with some pretty radical things in contrary circumstances for about a year and a half, coming at us from so many different ways, and really, it's because don't stop yet. I'm not finished singing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord. I'll let you know. Just follow my leadership. And then you can praise God. Amen? Amen. Learn how that much more to follow the leadership of the Holy Ghost. True. And a lot of it is just because of the things that the Lord is setting us up to do. Satan will come out to try to discourage us. He'll blindside us. There's demonic assignments. But you know what? Satan can't do anything. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. And what we do is we just stand by and we just watch God go to work on our behalf. We don't have to defend ourselves. I speak when God opens my mouth and tells me to speak. One time somebody said, why don't you defend yourself? Why don't you just talk up? Man, if you don't talk up, goodness gracious, who's going to talk up for you? God. I need to talk up. I talk up when he puts a fire on the inside of me. Hallelujah. I talk up when it's time to shout. Hallelujah. I talk up when it's time to magnify the Lord. But you know what? I mean, there's something about being the servant of the Lord and walking in the Holy Ghost and being led by him. Praise God. I came back from a number of things we've been dealing with just over the past 6-7 months. It's probably been one of the most difficult things we've ever dealt with. When we came back from Japan, the Lord spoke to me. He said, call the fire of God down on everything. Call it down on everything. Call it down on everyone. Call it down on the church. Call it down on every circumstance. Call it all down on every situation. Do what I'm telling you and I'll judge it. Hallelujah. And somebody said, oh my goodness, that's terrible. He's a judgment preacher. Well, it's a good news judgment preacher. That good news judgment. Because Scripture says if you chase it on the Lord and judged, amen, hallelujah, then you're not going to be condemned with the world. Say, I'll take mine now. Choice A, to be judged of the Lord and chastened. Choice B, condemned with the world. I'm going with choice A. Hands down, hallelujah. You know, Father deals with us. He gives us a lot of time to repent. Even those things that Satan would use to try to destroy us, God will use it to turn it around to promote us. He'll turn it around and make it a blessing. I mean, even the worst circumstances, in the worst situations. When you trust in him, hallelujah. When you stand on his side, praise God, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Say continually, the Lord be magnified in me. The Lord be magnified in me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, say continually, the Lord be magnified in me, the Lord be magnified in me. Hallelujah. Praise the name. Just one more shout and shout to Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. You know, I'm in great expectation for greater works to be seen. There's been wonderful things God's done in the earth and wonderful things that have happened in the last 100 years. Wonderful things that happened in the last 150 years. Let me just back it up that far. Great things that happened in the last 60 years. And just like seeming, in some respects, to constantly increase in momentum and glory and demonstration of the power of God. It's kind of like, I look at it like this, that Jesus is already, as it were, returning to us, if you would, to come get us, so that to receive us unto himself, and that on his time scale, as it were, every step that he takes getting closer to grab a hold of us, his manifest glory increases. Now, I'm using that in a very loose kind of a way. The bottom line of it is, the increase of his government, there is no end. He right now has all authority in heaven and in earth. And I know that Father has set his heart on demonstrating his love, demonstrating his power to all men. And he's always done that through great signs and wonders and miracles. He did and worked miracles so that men would believe. And because of the miracles which he did and the great signs and wonders which he did, many believed on him. Signs and wonders and miracles like he did with Lazarus when he raised Lazarus from dead. Many people didn't just come to see Jesus. They came to see Lazarus because many believed upon him because of Lazarus being raised up from the dead. And, you know, I see there were a lot of folks that didn't believe too. But the bottom line of it is God works miracles for that purpose. And he works miracles to show his love and grace and to demonstrate his goodness to all men. You know, it's a wonderful thing that God would demonstrate his love to a paraplegic person and they get up and walk around. And that's what we call a miracle, God demonstrating his love to the sick and the dying and the hurting and the afflicted. It's a wonderful thing when God demonstrates his love to those people who are mentally insane and tormented with vexing depression. Oh, what a glorious, wonderful grace of God when somebody's able to come to such a person and such dire need and speak the word of life and they just instantaneously get liberated. What happens then? Jesus, hallelujah, is glorified. Father's glorified in his son and his church is seen to be living and operating the power of Jesus Christ, who is the one far above all principalities and powers and might and every work of darkness, is manifestly declared right now to be absolutely sure and certain and verifiably true to every man, so that nobody is without excuse. Huh? He says to Bethsaida and Chorazin, he said, look, if the mighty works which had been done, it was done in you, had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would last unto this day. He's saying, because of the miracles, you are left without any excuse. And I know what Jesus did, and I know what he's preached, and I know what he ministered, and everybody else does too that reads Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, okay? And then we know what he left, the things that he promised and said he would do after that he was ascended up on high, the power that he said he would entrust to the church. We know it was verified in Acts. We see it verified in all those things that everybody who called upon his name and believed did. We see it verified in Romans and 1st and 2nd Corinthians. We see it verified all the way through the Bible to the end of the last amen in Revelation 22:21. Amen. Hallelujah. And right now, I know that this is God's purpose for us to go everywhere, preach the gospel, casting out devils, laying hands on the sick. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. And so that's just exactly what we're going to do. Father is putting people into place, positioning them right now in every part of the earth, in every part of the United States of America, for a great outpouring of his power. You know, I heard today, as they were saying on the news, how that the United States of America has taken its stand against Russia because Russia doesn't share our principles. And so we're going to, our president will not go there because they don't share our values, our lofty values of recognizing, that homosexuality is a thing that we're supposed to value. And, you know, folks think, well, my goodness, where is it all going? Where does immorality come to an end? Where does this apostasy slow up? Well, I'm going to tell you, when Father begins to work by the mighty power of his only begotten Son through the midst of his church, and I'm going to say that once again, Father will begin to work by his mighty power through his only begotten Son in the midst of his church. Somebody said, well, just Father, please send Jesus. Jesus has already come. He's exalted right into the Father. He's poured out the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is here. The Holy Ghost is invisible to the eyes of man, and he's going to work through the church to execute everything that Christ Jesus established when he purchased us with his own blood at Calvary, rose from the dead, was exalted to the right hand of the Father, and he's sitting there until every one of his enemies are made his footstool. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And, the Lord tells us in Matthew chapter 21, and Mark chapter 11, and I really like most of the times we quote this verse of scripture out of Mark 11:24, but also Matthew 11:21. I mean Matthew 21, what is it? Matthew 21:21 or 22? What is it? where Jesus said, whatever you ask, if you'll believe it, if you believe that I'll do it, whatever you ask, huh? Matthew 21, 22, do you see that?
Yeah.
Whatever you ask, if you believe that you receive it, it'll be yours, whatever you ask. Do you see that?
Yeah.
I was ministering to you just the other night about how this is the reason the Father elected us and chose us. He didn't choose you. Didn't choose him. He chose you, so you can take the pressure off right now.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Praise God.
The pressure's off. He chose you, and he's ordained you so that you could do something by his power and by his authority and by his grace. You know what that is?
Yes.
That whatever you ask the Father in Christ Jesus' name, Father will do it. So that relationship will ultimately be seen and established. He said, and that of course that's John. In 15:16, Jesus said in John 14:13, whatever you ask the Father in my name, I will do it. Come on.
Yeah.
This is the last statements he's saying. This is the last night he's going to be with the disciples. He's telling them, guys, listen, things are going to get real exciting around here. Things are going to get really exciting around here. Huh? And then he goes to John chapter 16, and what is it, verse 23, 24, he said, I tell you, I'm not going to have to ask the Father for you in that day. In that day, after I've ascended up on high, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will do it. Because why? He loves you. Man, if you could see how excited Father is about us shouting over him and getting excited over him, you'd shout more and you'd get excited a whole lot more. People would think he's just an old, stale, stoic man. You're not just an old, stale, stoic man, grumpy. Can't hardly move, then hardly nothing moves. I mean, seen everything, done everything, been everywhere. I mean, you know, that's not Father.
No.
There's not Father. Mm-hmm. No. Hallelujah. To see Father, if you want to begin to get a look at Father, you got to look at the lowliness and meekness of Jesus. Hallelujah. You got to look at the tenderness and the goodness of Christ Jesus. And, then of course, when we look in Mark chapter 11, verse 24, the Lord says, when you pray, when you're standing there praying, whatever you ask the Father, if you believe that you receive it, you shall have those things that you've asked. Huh? Isn't that beautiful? Who believes that? Who believes that? This is out of a realm of obedience, because a lot of people get into a place, they asking God for stuff and they're not going to obey. God say, no, you change. And then like in the next verse in 25, in Mark 11, 25, he said, and if you, while you're standing there praying, you remember somebody's, you got unforgiveness towards somebody, you got to get that right. Because I'm going to tell you right now, Father's not going to listen to you. God's not going to listen to you. His ears are open and his eyes are towards his face, his countenance, his pleasure, his grace towards those that do righteously. But those who do wicked, his face is against them. His ears are open unto the prayers of the righteous. Huh? But he's not going to listen to anything the wicked have to ask. And I'm telling you, right there, when you look at that verse of Scripture, you understand that in that verse of Scripture that Peter is quoting from Psalms 34, he's talking about people who aren't doing right within the framework of pursuing peace with those around them. They speak evil with their lips and guile. Huh? So he says, you got to get this right. You want to move forward? People praying, crying out to God. Saying, oh God, work this miracle for me. Do these things for me. And he wants to. He's promised to do them. But their heart's not right. They're not willing to change. I have dealt with people over and over again where I stood before them and I said, listen, this day the Lord wants to do a great miracle for you. The strongholds that are in your life, he wants to break them. I'm telling you, if you will listen to me and you will repent and turn from the things that you are doing that you know are wrong, God will show himself to you in a way you never thought possible. And I've had many people get up and walk away mad and go say all kinds of terrible things about me that, whatever. There was their opportunity. I've had a few who said I were going to repent and their life changed around, turned around. So the reality of it is, people, when you begin to start moving in these things with God, then you're going to have to understand that believe has a whole lot to do with the life that you live. Believe is not some philosophical ideology that you you know, you ascribe to. People think it's just some kind of mental assent. Well, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. The devils believe that. What does it value to them? What value does it have for them? Does it bring to them a relationship with the Lord? Does it bring to them the abundance of life that God has for us, the goodness of God's presence? Absolutely not. So there is a place in which we believe where it becomes, this is the life that we live. This is our existence, okay? This is our existence in Him. This is our relationship. And when you look at verses of Scripture, like John 14:13, John 14:10 through 11, it's right there nested in this amazing, intimate relationship. Its context is a place of oneness with God, empowerment with God, a place where that your whole life is just consecrated over to the wonderful things that He's done for us. And that's why there in John 14:12, right there in that same context, the Lord saying, whatever you ask in My name, I'll do it. He says, you're going to do these works or greater works than these because they go to My Father. Why? Because whatever you ask in My name, I'll do it. Are you with me? Hallelujah. Go ramang jete kara manda dela. What happens when all of a sudden you begin to let God judge every part of your life? Huh? What happens when you begin to let, what happens when you begin to take a hold of this walk with the Lord Jesus Christ to where everything about your life is conformed to Him, and anything that tries to bring you out of that or draw you away from that, you deny it. Listen, you know, you might have noticed the other day, I tweeted, or rather, yeah, well, I did that, and also on Twitter and also on Facebook, I put that we're supposed to lay down our lives as the Lord Jesus taught us so that things can be right. We don't lay down our lives so things can continue to be wrong. The Lord Jesus Christ laid down His life so that we could be right, not so that we could continue to be wrong. It's time that we recognize that He has empowered us to walk in obedience. He will there keep us and protect us and uphold us so that we can learn perfect obedience. As long as our heart's right, I mean, it might take time to grow and mature. It might take some time to be prepared unto every good work. But all the way through, He's going to uphold His word. He's going to be faithful concerning these things. Now, there is an atmosphere of our life that we got to watch out for. And I'm going to point some of these things out to you quickly. And then one of those things I want to point out to you here is in Mark. So turn to Mark chapter, I believe it's Mark chapter 8. Turn to Mark chapter 8 with me. And look at verse 22. You know, Bethsaida, Jesus had done a lot of miracles in Bethsaida. It doesn't talk to us, the scripture doesn't talk to us about all the things He did in Bethsaida, but we know that He, several different times, the scripture highlights how that He healed everybody there along the coast, in the coast of Jordan there in Bethsaida. How that He did, everybody who was diseased were cured. And then it came to a point that Bethsaida began to harden its heart, that city, just like Capernaum, began to harden its heart against the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because of religious influences, more than likely. Mostly because of religious influences. They begin to harden their hearts. And then Jesus pronounces the ultimate judgment. Woe unto you, Bethsaida. Woe unto you, Chorazin. Woe unto you, Capernaum. Just before he leaves this world, in about the last 6 months of His ministry. Because they would not repent. Why did He do the miracles and the signs and wonders for? He walked in and He overrode, in many respects, He overrode all the opposition that otherwise would have stopped an Elijah. It would have stopped a Jonah. It would have stopped a person of the Old Testament. But because of His anointing, because of the immeasurable grace of God that was poured out through Christ Jesus, He went beyond that, and all these wonderful works and all these wonderful goodness of God was displayed to these people that resulted in very little change. And so here he is now in Bethsaida. It's towards the end of his ministry. And there's a blind man there who would be healed. You see this in verse 22? And he come to Bethsaida, and there being a blind man, and a blind man came and besought him that he would, that Jesus would touch him. Jesus was known for his touch. Anybody, and also, not only was he known for his touch, he was also known that if anybody would touch him, they would be perfectly healed. This was a great revival, this three-year revival. It's one of the reasons I just love reading the Gospels over and over again. I found that you can read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in 2 weeks. Easy reading time, about 10, 11 pages a day, depending on what your Bible looks like. And that's why I did the sequential events of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm actually doing a book right now on the miracles of Jesus. But reality of it is, that's what the church is supposed to look like. That's what a church service is supposed to look like. My preaching and my teaching here tonight will be with the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. There will be an atmosphere created by the preaching tonight. There will be a work of grace happen. There will be an availability for change to take place, because it's really all about the church coming into a state of yieldedness and cooperation with the Holy Ghost, so that the ministry of Jesus can be seen in San Diego County, so the ministry of Jesus can be seen anywhere the church exists. You don't see a religious institution. You see the person of Jesus Christ being revealed. And, you know, I can't wait to get this book in your hands so you can, because I've categorized all the miracles, whether it's word of knowledge, whether it's translation. Jesus had the ability to hide himself and pass right through the midst of the crowd that was looking for him. Just great things, you know. What took place when the glory of God began to be manifested on his body and his clothing and his earthly tabernacle. You know, we call it the Mount of Transfiguration. All the various different categories of miracles, those things that surround those miracles. Because, see, I believe that God wants to give us wisdom and insight to function and operate with the Holy Ghost. And if we're hungry for that wisdom and then that insight, then we're going to pour over it. I discovered that every man that ever functioned in great signs and wonders and miracles actually wrote some kind of book about signs and wonders and miracles. Like F.F. Bosworth, Christ the Healer. Okay? A.A. Allen, Jesus the Miracle Worker. Hallelujah. One of the things that we're going to do right after the first of the year is we're going to start the School of the Spirit. I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be an awesome time. More than likely, it's going to be on Friday night at 7 o'clock. I'm going to have a library of books on prayer, because prayer and understanding prayer is so much about being developed in the School of the Spirit. The School of the Spirit, what is that? The Lord Jesus said the Holy Ghost is going to come and teach us everything. So we need to get into school so we can be taught by him. You know, I have a whole library on the word of knowledge, on the working of miracles, on the gifts of healing, on, you know, on faith. Just, you know, just get you saturated on prophecy, tongues, interpretation of tongues. And you know, of late, not too many people written much of anything on interpretation of tongues, you know. And so we just going to have to get after it. And we're going to have, you know, I pray in Jesus' name, you will have such an encounter with the power of God. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you become a champion in this ministry for interpretation of tongues. You know, God raises up champions. And then that river that's giving them, that impartation given to them, just flows out on everybody else. And then everybody else begins to start partaking of the same grace. That's the way it works. He raised up a champion in a gift of healing. He'll raise up another champion in miracles, another champion in faith. And then, I mean, once you learn how to function, operate in one of the gifts of the Spirit, you'll discover that every other one of them are coming right along with them. As you're strengthened in one area, you're strengthened in others. I don't think there's any greater gift than the gift of faith. And I want to see God's people start functioning in it, but it's an atmosphere. It's an atmosphere. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, because of the situation of Bethsaida, the atmosphere wasn't right. And it had come to a place that the atmosphere was so opposed to the working of God, Jesus had to take the blind man and lead him out of Bethsaida. Had to take him out of the city, had to take him out away from all of that mess that was opposing God. They were in unbelief. I mean, look at the disciples. They get in unbelief in Matthew chapter 18. They get in unbelief. Here they're given such power and they're moving in such authority. And they get themselves in a situation with a boy who's possessed with a devil. And all of a sudden other influences come around them and start questioning them, start challenging them, start distracting them, start giving, you know, credence to some other power that's causing this. Jesus just simply says it's because of your unbelief that the authority shut down. The miracle couldn't flow out of you. The power that I gave you to go and do this wouldn't work simply because of your unbelief. People, you're going to have to recognize that you carry a personal responsibility in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ for how free the Holy Spirit is to do that which He wants to do. He doesn't do anything in the midst, or He does very little in the midst of criticism, a critical eye, suspicion, fear, doubt, unbelief, heartache, turmoil, envy. He does very little. We got to keep our hearts with all diligence, you know. You know, Jesus said, you know, when the Pharisees were after Him, they said, you disciples, what kind of disciples you got anyway? They don't wash their hands. I mean, but Greg, that's a lofty goal for a disciple. You know, my goodness gracious. And Jesus said, you don't understand that what goes into a man cannot defile him, because it doesn't go into his heart. Something goes in your heart and it defiles you. Praise God for the blood of Jesus. The red blood of Jesus that breaks the power of every power unlike God. Praise God for the blood that'll make you clean again. But the reality of it is too many people sit in spiritual uncleanness. They do not want to change. They want the pastor and everybody else to lay down their life for their wrongdoing. No, we'll not. We will not. We'll lay down our lives so that you can change so long as you want to get right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But there's a bigger program going on here. I discovered what God will do when He can get one man to pay attention to Him like a Gideon. He might not come from the right family. He might not come from the right city. He might not come from the right town. Huh? But when a man is willing to just begin to step out and show any inclination towards courage, towards bravery, towards, say, recognizing his inheritance. That's all Gideon did. He just started recognizing his inheritance. He's going, wait a minute, this is my stuff. I can have a little bit. They told me I can't have any of my stuff. This is mine. I'm going to have some of my stuff. Or like Shamgar. Shamgar said, listen, wait a minute. This is the king's highway. This is my inheritance. Why must I be subjugated to such abuse by the Philistines? And all he had in his hand was what he prodded his oxen to get going forward when they got stuck, when the plow was bogging down. That's all he needed. God's looking for somebody to just exercise a little bit of bravery, a little bit of courage. Hallelujah. So I said, well, why do you get mad and upset, start screaming and yelling? I'm not mad, I'm not upset, and I'm not screaming and yelling. It's passion. It's fire. It's just, kitaramasataye. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was telling someone in my dream last night, I said, well, you know, I only yell when I feel opposing powers of darkness. When I yell in Jesus' name, they all flee. I break off their strongholds. When there's nothing but glory, I whisper. When every power of darkness is run off and every demon spirit has no more right to work and try to oppose the word of God, oh, I speak sweetly with a big smile on my face the whole time. Hallelujah. And I'd like to speak sweetly with a big smile on my face all the time. Praise God. Jesus died so that we might be made right. Am I going to abide a wrong situation? No. I'm giving my life too. I'm going to follow Him. I understand deny myself and take up my cross and follow Him differently than a lot of people. I understand to do it for the same reasons He did it and expect the same results that He expected. I don't think that should be too far of a stretch for anyone. Do you? Seeing as we're His disciples and we're following Him. Amen. Say amen. Amen. Give me a powerful, resounding amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I am the enemy of afflicting, tormenting spirits that would put diseases upon people. It is not biological, physiological. It's not chemical. is demonic. It's evil spirits afflicting and tormenting men. Hallelujah. And I believe with all my heart that the Lord's going to do things as he did in the past, where there'll be maybe, you know, as many as there were of the Baalites standing against Elijah, saying it's not true, but there's one man bold enough, full of the anointing enough to believe God and withstand them all. And then the power of God proves who it is that is on God's side and speaking on his behalf and proving also that he is God, because he's the God who does everything in a realm out of heaven. God doesn't do anything in a realm out of earth. If it's done in out of a realm out of earth, then it's normal. Something anybody can do. What he does, he does it out of the realm out of heaven. Anytime you see a miracle, you see heaven shining into the earthly realm. Everything that God does out of heaven is a miracle, supernatural signs and wonders. It's authority over the elements. It's the ability to defy physical laws, to be instantaneously translated from one place to the other. I love where he, you know, I was just staring at that miracle today, just going back 2,000 years ago and watching Jesus walk upon the water at night in Matthew. And hallelujah. And they were afraid and fearful because when they saw him come walking upon the stormy sea, they thought he was but a phantom, a spirit. He said, "No, be not afraid. It's I." And he got in the boat and they were instantly at the shore. Wow. My goodness. Wow, hanging out with Jesus. I'm hanging out with Jesus. I'm not going to model my life after an earthly ministry. Satan will try to stop. He will come out with rage against anybody who tries to break out of the confines of his religious domain. Anybody who tries to break out of the confines of that which the human realm and human limitation would restrict us to, Satan comes out with his hordes to attack us in every possible way. But no weapon that he forms against us can prosper. We stand over here. Hallelujah. 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 You know, I've heard some of my friends say, well, watch out, because when you start moving in that place, you know, and the enemy comes, attacks your family, and people die, and people get diseased and sick. I never believed that doctrine, man. I didn't see that happen to Jesus. Huh? I don't know what was going on in your life, you know, but I didn't see that happen to Jesus. Huh? Yeah, there are things, listen, there are things that get us blindsided. There are things that come at us. And you know, maybe we had warnings. Well, we did. I mean, there's times we didn't have warnings. I mean, I think probably most of the trouble we get ourselves into is we don't heed the warnings. Because I believe God always is warning us. He's always showing us. But we sometimes refuse to listen, and because we want to pursue our own interests, our own will, our own pleasure. If Father's good towards us in that way and teaches us how not to do that, teaches us how to walk soberly before him, and not, he trains us where we're not willing to budge outside of his leadership. Amen. Isn't that good? So, but there may take a lot of time in process of maturation and, you know, and maturing and growing. There might be a considerable amount of time in the development and being prepared. But all the time, God is faithful. When I first started in the ministry, I looked at people who had diseases that couldn't be cured. And I said, in Jesus' name, you're cured. And they got cured. Many people. You can go ahead and say amen, or you can be silent and disbelieve. Whatever you want. Say praise God. You should say praise God, because maybe that's you. Maybe that's you. Maybe you're just getting started and you don't want to think, I got to wait 30 years. If I realize that I'm just getting started and I could begin, and there's models that show me that, you know what, I don't have to wait 5 years, 10 years. I don't have to wait next year, today, right now, I can begin to move. Because whatever God said, he's made it available right now. I'd get amen. I'd get excited about it. I'd go, praise God, I'm glad to hear that. That's good. Man, because I was right on the edge. I was wondering. I wanted to ask, Pastor, by the way, how long do I have to wait? Then I let the news out quickly. Before you even ask. You don't have to wait at all. You don't have to wait at all. Hallelujah. It just, as you grow and mature, faith grows and matures to the point that when you deal with opposition that 5 years ago, 10 years ago would have stopped you, now it can't stop you. Huh? When you deal with threats and when you deal with discouraging things, it can't hold you back. When you deal with distractions and all the wiles of Satan that come to slow you down or hinder you, it doesn't have the same impact or effect. It can't ultimately going to a place in God where it cannot touch me. Amen? Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
And he took the blind man by the hand. He led him out of the town. And he spit. That is, the Lord has some interesting ways. Huh? Led him out of the town. Got him out of town. And he spit on his eyes. It's all right. The guy didn't see it coming. And he laid his hands on him and he said, could you see? The atmosphere was so opposing. The Son of God, the miracle worker, the sign and wonder man who was like no other man that had ever lived. Listen to me. You need to listen to me. Make the Word of God more important to you than anything else. Listen to me. I am firsthand experience of being distracted by the enemy and by circumstances and situation right at the most important time and not hearing that most important thing that I need to hear. I've really learned to pay attention. I just want to encourage all of you, just grab a hold of the Word of God. Don't let go. Understand that these are words of life. This changes you. This God, every word counts. Every word counts. It really does. Every word of God is profitable. Every word here is important to you. Here is Jesus with unlimited faith, unlimited power. And now, look at the opposition. Can you see? The man looked up and he saw trees. He saw men as trees. Walking. Jesus put his hands on him again. It's almost like back to Elijah's days. Back to Elisha. What is he dealing with? He's dealing with the atmosphere of unbelief. He's dealing with the atmosphere that opposes the movings of God. Men's will is a very powerful thing to deal with. The realms of unbelief that happen within the framework of communities is a very powerful opposition against the working of God's mighty power, even to the point that men with their will can defy the will of God. Watch yourself. Watch yourself. I'm watching myself. I'm watching you. I'm a watchman. Watch yourself. Watch yourself. Walk humbly with your God. Love mercy. Do what's right. Huh? I'm not moving here. I'm not moving to the right or to the left unless I say, I'm always going, Father, I'm not making a decision. You judge it. Father, you judge it. I'm not making a decision. You judge it, oh God. Pour your judgment upon it. I'm going to stand here and I'm going to pray for the blessing and I'm going to pray for the peace of whoever it is or whatever situation it is that is opposing. But Father, I'm looking to you. Thy will be done. You judge it. You lead me in the way everlasting. I'm going to keep myself right here in forgiving. If anybody asks for forgiveness, we're going to forgive them. We're dealing with a situation, one of the most opposing situations that we've ever had to deal with. And the person doesn't want any forgiveness. They think that they're right when they're totally, absolutely wrong and doing such violation and have been doing such violation against us. We stand right here. If they ask for forgiveness, all they got to do is ask for forgiveness and we forgive. But Father, you judge it. You judge it. Send your fire and judge it. People, that's where we've got to live our lives. You mean we got to live our lives right here now? Huh? You got to let God be God. He's really, really God. He wants to be your God, and he wants you and me to be his people. And when he steps in, when he's given that place, when he's given, as it were, that permission in our lives, I'm telling you right now, everybody's going to know. It might take a few days. It might take a few months. It might take a few years, but everybody's going to know that God's your God and you're his person. He's on your side, and you're on his side, that you won with him, that he upholds you and upholds you. Those things that you speak and those things that you do. But I don't expect Father to uphold anything, any wrong thing I do. I expect him to forgive me when I repent. And he will. Isn't that good? And I want to be in a place where he can uphold me. I want to be in a place where I glorify his name, where he can be glorified through our lives. We want to be in a place in this church where he can be glorified. I'm telling you, the school of evangelism is going to be in divine order. Satan is not going to work his works. and try to stop it because of the pride and egotism of men and because of the strife of men, because that's the first thing Satan tries to do. I'm telling you right now, the school of the Spirit is going to prosper in this place. That's going to cause people to mature in the workings and the gifts of the Holy Ghost. And Father's fire is going to be constantly burning on it. Constantly burning on it. I mean, I'm telling you, I was talking to a man about, a great man of God about 15 years ago, and I said, you know, it's time to see the diversity of ministry in the body of Christ. He said, yeah, but if that started happening, we'd have people dying like Ananias and Sapphira, because God would have to judge it. God would have to judge the rebellion. He'd have to judge the things that they do wrong when they begin to touch the sacred things of the anointing, because look at how they're behaving themselves now. What happens? Father wants to promote us, but we disqualify ourselves. He's not going to bless us to the point that it destroys us. He's waiting for us to be able to cooperate with him and obey with him in such a way that the blessing will be a promotion. Hallelujah. And a destruction. There's many examples that we can give of that. There's one. I just want to hold you responsible for the atmosphere of your life. The atmosphere of your life is going to be determined by what you do tomorrow. It is how you walk with the Lord tomorrow. The atmosphere of your life has an impact on the church. People, don't get me wrong. Don't misunderstand me. I want everybody to come. Okay, if up here, but I'm dealing with a vision to see literally 1,000 people that are lost in the building, with all the unclean spirits, with all the ugliness, with all the nastiness, with all the stuff that's going on. I need some people who know how not to be touched by the powers of darkness and pulled by the enemy through his subtle means to stop the flow of God. I'm looking to see something happen that's not happening anywhere else. I'm looking to see people get delivered, have an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ, be set free, healed of every disease and every affliction. There's an atmosphere that they will not be responsible for. Every wicked person can come, and they cannot change this one little bit that I'm talking about, this flow of the Holy Ghost. But God's people that are held responsible, that have been brought into the body of Christ, are the covenant people, and they refuse to do what God says to do. They can have an impact. And we're calling to you tonight just to recognize that you have a responsibility here in the body of Christ to connect with love. And I pray that's not burdensome to you. Hallelujah. To connect with hugs and grace and mercy and forgiveness and saying, here we are. Here we are. Just you know, giving yourself to the body of Christ. To love one another as Christ Jesus loved us and gave himself for us. Oh, dear people, to be able to show that kind of love to the vilest looking neighbor that walks through the door, because they're getting ready to walk through the door. Are you listening to me? I believe, I'm believing God that Sunday mornings are going to be jam-packed with kids eventually out there in that parking lot from every walk of life. And we're going to take them, and by the grace of God, we're going to love on them and minister to them and see them process right into the kingdom of God. I'm believing God to see every kind of creature come walking through those doors on Sunday morning. I'm believing God that every Sunday night, I just had an email from someone who received an invitation 2 years ago from somebody in Scripps Ranch. This person said, I received an invitation 2 years ago in this email I received today. And in the invitation, it said that you had healing meetings on Sunday night. 2 years ago. And by judging from the last name, I'm pretty sure they're Jewish. My mother-in-law is sick of a disease. And we're all coming on Sunday night. Look, you know, and for me, I'm not looking for, and it didn't happen with Jesus. It didn't, I'm not looking for thousands to come on the first day. And we can't even handle 1,000 on the first day. Huh? We'd be overwhelmed, overrun. I mean, we could handle it. I can handle it. I've already prayed for thousands. Okay. I'm sure that by the grace of God, you would hook right in with me. You want to get distracted, start yawning, nodding off, getting upset with your wife or your husband? Are you listening to me? Yeah. Come on. But you would be in the excitement of the harvest that is coming in. Amen. Amen. But I'm excited the ministry of Jesus started with just one, then it built to 2, then to 10, then to 20, then to 100, then 1,000, then 10,000, then the great multitudes. I'm believing God for everybody who's coming into these meetings. a man of God, a preacher in Japan, was translating for me. And he went mute. And I didn't even begin to get upset because the power of God was so thick. You know, I said something and he's not answering. Or he's not interpreting. But I knew. He's out. I look over and he's in glory. His face, just shining with the brightness of God's goodness. He couldn't speak. His daddy's a preacher. He's one of the few Japanese men of God that we found. One of the few Japanese Christians. His daddy's a preacher. He emails me. We have a very short vacation because they pastor, but they also work. They have a very short vacation. We're coming on the 29th. Wow. We would like to not have to come during your holiday time, but we have no other time, and we got to be in the meeting. Huh? Come on, man. Come on. That has to do with an atmosphere that we get to be carriers of. I walked into Japan. I'm in a place now that not a person in the place has any impact on what I'm going to do. Not a person in the place. Because I'm there being sent by God to come and bring them something that they have no responsibility in terms of how that's delivered. And it's a very different dynamic for me. I love the dynamic because it's a joyful dynamic the whole time. I don't ever feel really like I'm having to be a pastor. You know what I'm saying? Pastors do things like correct, you know? And wow. And I'm believing, and I know that in a church, in the body of Christ, that could be even more powerful when people learn how to just be clothed with humility and walk in love and say, you know what, I'm just not allowing those thoughts anymore. I'm not allowing those things that can enter into my heart and defile me. Huh? It's not just fornication that defiles you. Strife. Jesus numbered it there in Mark. It's criticism. Knowing their thoughts that they had, he said to them, he rebukes them. He got after them. If this man were a prophet, he would know that this is a sinful woman that is touching him. Huh? My goodness, where is their heart at? Right? Right? I mean, come on, think about it, because that's not too far or too distant from what many of us experience and have to deal with spiritually. Oh no, he's what is he doing with her? Seeking and saving that which is lost. Moved with the compassion and the love of the Father. What he's Jesus doing is he's showing how Father feels about every evil, wicked person. And he doesn't reach out to hug them and touch them, to condone their state, to accept their person, but to deliver them and transform them. Because he's reached out to touch many people. He's reached out to give many people an opportunity, and they've refused to change. Many people in Israel, many people in the Bible days, many people in these days. When we look in Matthew chapter 18, we see something very similar. And of course, this is probably more familiar. Well, I'm sure it's more familiar to everybody else than the text that I just used. But when Jesus goes into his own hometown in Nazareth, in his own country, in his own house, he's having to deal once again with an atmosphere of unbelief. An atmosphere of familiarity. Huh? And they heard about his mighty works. They heard about the great things that he had done in all the areas of Jordan and Judea. And they basically have a smirk on their face. We know who he is. But Jesus, what are you into? We know you, man. And come around here acting all uppity. Are you with me? We know your mom and we know your dad. I've known you since you were just a little grommet. Been you since you were a little fingerling. I've known you. Because it's a fisherman's town, so they use fisherman language, right? Couldn't do anything there. Couldn't do anything. Couldn't do anything. Couldn't do anything. He could not, and he did not many mighty works there. Luke says, and he could do no works, save he healed a few sick people. A few people with a fever. Huh? Yeah. Fever go. He could command the wind and the wave, speak to the blind, they instantaneously see. There are certain places that you go. There are certain places that we see Jesus go in certain times when he goes into them. Everybody's healed of every disease. The maimed, people who had limbs cut off, they grow out. All of their diseases and all of their sickness, everyone who had infirmities, every demon spirit went out of those who were afflicted and tormented by them. 4,000 people get fed, loaves and fishes. I love how Jesus, I'm just reminded as I said that, how Jesus reminds the disciples when they're all concerned about the fact that they didn't bring any bread, they're not going to have any supper. You know, they're all concerned about the situation. They're being overwhelmed by some unbelief. Jesus encourages their faith by reminding them of the miracles. Hey, don't you remember the 5,000? How many baskets full did you take up? Don't you remember the 4,000? How many basketfuls did you take up? Wow. Hallelujah. I'm going to do something tonight.
Hallelujah.
Here in just a few minutes. I'm going to serve you communion. And I'm going to give to you as I've received from the Lord. There's an authority in communion. There's a fire of God in communion. Don't be too worried or concerned about things that you see changing around you, because I call the fire of God down on you. Don't be concerned that you can't get away with the things you've been cheating on, messing with, because I call fire down on you. Don't be concerned if things are going out of your life that you thought you were going to hold on to, because I call fire God down on you. Don't be concerned if you feel unsettled in what you've been believing, because I've called the fire God down on you. I was leaving South Korea and going into Japan. The Lord said, I give you the power to call fire down on my church in Japan. And then that got confirmed by some folks who are the leadership in the ministry of South Korea. So it wasn't just subjective. I mean, I know when the Lord's talking to me. But you know what? Even when we know the Lord's talking to me, we need people to tell us. Huh? And nobody infallible but God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. I told my kids, if I start acting weird when I get older, just here, I'm going to give you power over, attorney over me, lock me in a room somewhere. Put me on a tractor and let me go round and round in the field. Nobody infallible but God. But you know what? I'm not going to have that problem, because I'm going to keep myself right with God. I'm going to keep my heart right with God. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm going to stay in the realms of the anointing. I'm going to keep myself submitted.
Amen.
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 You know, we have an oversight board. We praise God. We have a board of people that here serve here in the ministry, an eldership board that serve here in the ministry, that help us with the steering of the church. And then we have an oversight board of ministers like Tim Hall, Evangelist Tim Hall, and others. That when we're doing things, we submit them to them and say, "What do you think? This is what's going on," because here's what the Lord's told us. Here's how the Lord said to do it. Here's what God said he would do when he did this and that and the other thing. What do you feel? What do you think? What do you feel in your spirit? We need that. You need that. You don't think you need it. You got some serious challenges coming forth in your life. Okay? The enemy will take advantage of that vulnerability. I tell you, it's good to have many layers of accountability. It's good. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 It's one thing to pray in front of people. Because when you start praying in front of people, you know, you feel a little self-conscious about making sure you don't sound stupid. You know what I'm saying? Everybody understand what I'm saying? You with me? And so in many respects, you're praying to the ears of people. Right? It's another thing to go into a room where you all by yourself and you're talking to God. And you don't feel like you're just speaking into the air, burning some time in a thing you call prayer. It's fine for it to start there. You got to start somewhere. But it's there in that place of being shut in with God and being alone with God. That as you begin to talk with Him, He's no longer, as it were, untouchable by you, unrealized by you. It's no longer a sense of, I'm just talking to the air and there's no response. But there's a translation. There's a place where you feel His presence. You're overwhelmed by His glory. You feel the glory of His love, the glory of His peace. Hallelujah. You speak and He answers. Hallelujah. You standing there in His presence praying, worshiping Him. And all of a sudden, things begin to happen and begins to speak. I believe if I can teach people how to give themselves over to this atmosphere of God's presence, then everything the Father's ever purposed for you to have just will automatically start happening. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to do that because it's going to make a difference as to how you're able to bring that participation that the Holy Spirit is designed for you to have in the body of Christ, in the midst of the church. That's going to make a huge difference in the way that the lost respond to Jesus Christ. You've got to understand this. Satan has tried to hide it. He's run all kinds of interference with it. He's run religious interference with it. He's run program interference with it. He's run men's ideas and concepts as interference with it. You name the tricks, he's pulled it out to try to prevent you and me from individually connecting with the glory of God. Something that isn't fully realized and developed as you sit right here in this chair, in this place here in the meeting. You're empowered, you're gifted by God, you're graced by God, you're encouraged by God, impartation comes, instruction comes, but the difference is going to make in your personal relationship when no one else is around. What's the atmosphere? What's the atmosphere? Hallelujah. What atmosphere are you carrying with you right now? What atmosphere? What things do you believe or what things are haunting you? What things or circumstances that you don't understand are pressing against you? What ideas or discouragements or events of your life has your mind captivated? What doubt, what unbelief is going on potentially that keeps you from experiencing His manifest glory? His glory is everywhere, but His glory is only manifested to those who yielded themselves to Him, who come to a place of consecration, a consecration that isn't just something that we do when we bow down at an altar or when we take communion. A consecration that is something that we do when we say, I pray from 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock. Or I give myself to the study of the Word from this time to that time. And when I have the opportunity, I get alone with the Lord. When I'm driving down in the car, my life, or when I'm driving in the car, or going here or going there, taking a walk, my life is about communion with God. I want to touch heaven. I want heaven to touch me. That's a different realm to people. It's a different realm. When you begin to allow that to be developed in your life, all these stuff, that all these things that would run interference, all these lies, all this confusion, all of these attacks, and boy, there are many. Watch what happens to you. Watch what happens to you. Huh? God strengthens you so He can fit you for the battle. Watch what happens to you. God gives you authority. Hallelujah. You know, I told my wife today, I said, you know what? I am going to be more authoritative than I've ever been in my life. Huh? People call it mean. I call it authoritative. I'm going to be more authoritative. I'm going to be stronger than I've ever been. Huh? I'm not listening and laying down to nothing that is out of divine order. Huh? Watch what happens. Watch what happens when authoritative comes out. It's like the light shining in a dark place. The cockroaches go running. Huh? Everything that did not want to submit gets the fire of God on it. They get a chance at that moment in time. Am I going to submit? Am I going to go with God? Or am I going to go my own way? And then they go and carouse with all the people down the street at the other religious institution and verify with one another that the person that shined the light and called the fire down was wrong. That's the way it works. Don't worry. It's not about any individual or any person. It's about Jesus. It's about a breakthrough to where that 3.2 million people in this region will have an encounter with God. It's about a breakthrough. And Satan always trying to set things up and stop us. He's trying to, there's attacks to invalidate you. There's demonic assignments to stop you. And there's only one place of protection where the Lord gives His authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy, so nothing can by any means hurt us. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Lang blown jackalate today. What are you going to do? What are you going to do? Are you going to recognize, as Jesus said when He was dealing with the disciples, and they have this first big bout with unbelief, people who are flowing in the anointing, and now they got this challenge that they've never had before, and they're having to deal with unbelief, and He says, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? Are you going to start fasting and praying now? Huh? Because now I'm up against a new area. Or am I just going to go, you know, I'm going to go do whatever, whatever. You know, I'm just going to go comfort myself. Huh? With creature comforts. Do you know does anybody recognize that has any bearing in the reality of your life? Could you just sneak your hand up just a little bit? Because if you can't see it, you can't change. When Jesus dealt with things, he went to prayer. When Jesus was being praised, He went up to the mountain to pray. When they were saying, we'll take you by force and make you king, He went to the mountain to pray. When all people were coming at Him from the right hand, left hand, discouragement, He said, went apart to pray. Get alone with Father. That's where strength comes from. That's where help comes from. That's where the life-changing authority of God's divine power begins to be realized through our life. Ain't nothing going to stop us. Listen, anybody who walks this way, who obeys Christ Jesus, nothing going to stop you. And nothing. Satan has not created a weapon that can stop you. Amen. He has not a thing that can stop you. People who are anointed of God, when they go through difficult times, they just get more ferocious. Why? Because fiery trials just make us shine brighter. That's just the way it works, man. Why? Because our faith, our walk, who we are, has nothing to do about the things that are around us. It has nothing to do with people's opinions. It has nothing to do with creature comforts and earthly things. It has nothing to do with lands and houses. It has nothing to do with anything that belongs to this temporal realm. That was radical. That was a radical rap. That was a radical shout.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. That was radical. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Halabasta kuriminatati hishikala datate. Larata patina namata kasapolu parada. Hallelujah. Venglosa peranina. Dista prona today. Just trying to think, how am I going to do this? How am I going to do communion here? Just waiting on the Lord, you know, waiting on the Lord for instruction. Hallelujah. The Lord tells us very clearly, says, don't eat and drink the body of Christ unworthily. Tonight, I'm going to say, tell you tonight, can I tell you tonight? You need to be worthy. Amen. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Should I read that to you? Is anybody saying, is that in the Bible? Yeah. You need to be worthy. Hallelujah. And the only way you got to get worthy is Christ Jesus makes you worthy. I got a song I sing to the Lord. Lord, I stand here now by the blood of your only begotten Son. I stand here boldly to worship you because of what you've done. I'm yours and you are mine. And I'm never leaving. I thank you that you'll never forsake me. Two. Huh? My songs. You got your songs? I got my songs. I got my radical private songs. It ain't meant for copyright. It ain't meant for entertainment. It belonged between me and him personally. Hallelujah. It's written just for his ears alone. You know what I'm saying? Come on. Hallelujah. There is a relationship for you to have. Satan will do everything to distract you with all the other earthly cares so you never realize what's really here. A room, a great big large room of heavenly interest that you can come and be consumed with. A fire of heaven that burns brighter and brighter every day that you walk with him. Worthy. Worthy. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is Christ Jesus, whose blood was poured out to wash me and cleanse me from my sin, that I might present myself a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto him. That's worthy, made worthy by him. Hallelujah. How can you become unworthy? Don't discern the body of Christ. How do you become unworthy? Don't discern the body of Christ. Both his church corporately, the people that are in it, knowing who is around you, honoring them and loving them in the way that God has told us to honor and love one another, to love one another with the same love that he's loved us. Oh, man, if you've got aught in your heart towards anyone, get it right. That's what he says. Don't you in any way come and start partaking of that element that represents this grace and this glory that has redeemed us from hell. All men cry out, as Tennyson did when they faced death, but all the prayers in heaven and earth cannot change your course once you step from this life into the next. Your eternal place is sealed. 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 Tonight you choose. Tonight you choose. You think you can delay it till tomorrow. You think that you can wait till next year. You think that you've got time. Tonight you choose. You listen to me. Those of you that are watching by web, both friend and foe, tonight you choose. Tonight, you choose. Watch the power of God at work. Watch his grace, his mercy, as he reaches out to every soul. But watch his judgments, for they are just as true. He will not allow his son's name to be profaned forever. He will not allow his servants to always be ridiculed. He stands on the side of those who stand with him. He stands and walks with those who are completely consecrated to do his will, who've humbled themselves before him, and nothing is too hard. Nothing that God requires or asks is too difficult. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We've recently had some people rise up and say, we do not have to listen to your leadership. We don't have to listen to your authority. We don't have to listen to the things that you've got to say. We have what we believe. And if you're going to be right with God, you must choose what we choose. Maybe if you were Evangelist Tim Hall, and some other people that I could name right now, I'd have to sit and listen. But woman, women, and people of a different faith don't have anything, nothing to say. I have no ears to hear. God's called every man to repent. He's called everyone to change and walk this way. His divine order cannot be compromised. You compromise His divine order and you forfeit your opportunity in a ministry call. You got to have to walk in divine order. Husbands, you're going to have to walk in divine order. Wives, you're going to have to understand, men, you follow Jesus as Jesus follows His Father. Women, you have to understand, you follow your husband as Jesus follows the Father. Men, you're going to have to obey Christ Jesus as Christ Jesus obeys the Father. Women, you're going to have to obey your husbands as Christ Jesus obeys the Father. It can't be compromised. It cannot be compromised. Divine order cannot be compromised. And you'd be right. Men are going to have to understand how to live and dwell with their wives according to knowledge, lest their prayer be hindered. And that's according to knowledge, knowing that God demands divine order. He demands you to rule your house and command your children. He does. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God commands us to rule His house. He commands us to not even accompany with the brother who's a drunkard. He commands us to separate ourselves from those who name the name of Jesus but continue to practice iniquity. He does. He commands it. Hallelujah. Praise God. There's always an opportunity to repent. Huh? There's lots of people who leave the house of God. There's lots of people who run off. They leave when all the time the Lord had an opportunity for them to be promoted. Nobody told them to leave. No one asked them to leave. They left because they rebelled. They said, no, not going to follow that. Not going to believe that. Happens all the time to Christ Jesus. Happens all the time in the kingdom of God. What will you do? I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to follow the Lamb wherever the Lamb goes. Wherever He goes, I'm going to go there too. I'm never going out anymore. Whatever He says, whatever's wrong, I'm going to repent of. Whatever's right, and it's wrong and right's not subjective. It's right there in the Word of God. Huh? Come on now. Listen to me. Are you listening to me? Listen to me. Nobody has a right to walk out of the house of God, leave and blame it on someone else. Huh? No woman has a right to take a ring off, throw it down, and leave and say, if you want to have a relationship with me, come follow me. Huh? No person has a right to leave. Huh? Throw their covenant in the face of God and say, Lord Jesus, or church, if you want to have a relationship with me, if you want me to attend, you have to come go do what I'm doing. Nonsense. Nonsense. There's an opportunity. There's an opportunity. There's a sacrifice made available for you. All you got to do is pick it up and repent. Say, Jesus, I'm sorry. Forgive me. I want to make it right. There's plenty of forgiveness in Father's house. Plenty of mercy in Father's house. And there are many people that are stubborn. Many people who are absolutely right in their own eyes. That's religion. And that power of darkness would try to do everything it possibly can do to run interference with the things that God wants to do to redeem the lost. Look, tonight I'm going to serve you communion. I want you to consecrate yourself to walking with Jesus, to having a personal relationship with Him, to where that the atmosphere of your life carries an interaction with His love, His grace, His goodness, His mercy. Let that interaction come to the point where when you pray, when you're talking to Him, that the very room is charged with His glory. I guarantee you, all the rest of the gifts of the Spirit will begin to manifest and they'll begin to flow. Your place in the body of Christ will not be abstract or elusive to you. Boom, you'll plug right in. Let me say this. God demands oneness. He does. He demands it on every level. He demands us to be one with Him. And unless two agree, they cannot walk together. They cannot be one. And I'm going to tell you right now, God's not going to agree with us. Somebody's got to be the leader. Are you listening to me? The only person that can argue with God is you and me, because he can't argue with himself. He demands. He pleads with us. He wrestles with us. Please hear my voice. Please hearken unto my word. This is what he's saying. Hallelujah. Stoko ramagata sete. Lang ling bong daya. I hope no one's too big of a hurry tonight. Lose the berenana. She's got to have her little pacifier. Lord Jesus, bless the little baby right here. Come over here. Let me get you over this way. Hey, Mrs. Graham. Hey, Mrs. Graham. She's got her war bonnet on tonight. Hey. Oh, good. You got a tether on that thing. That bite the dust. Hey, Mrs. Graham, a wonderful thing. Family's a wonderful thing, you know. There's nothing so beautiful as raising children and grandchildren in the midst of divine order. They'll all be filled with the Holy Ghost. How many of you got to compromise that? How many going to run the risk of having your children, your grandchildren taken out just because you're being stubborn? Just because you're being unbending, unwilling to change, unwilling to repent, unwilling to humble yourself, unwilling to walk in meekness, unwilling to walk in the Word of God. Ain't nobody coming around with some subjective ideas of do this thing and do that thing. We're just declaring the Word of God to you. This is what Jesus says. Deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. He's got a divine order that he's described to us, and it's a beautiful divine order. Husbands, listen. You must understand. Christ Jesus demands that you love your wives, even as Jesus loved the church and gave himself for it. Understand the context. Jesus gave himself for the church so that the church could be changed. Hallelujah. And come into a place of submission to him to follow his leadership. Are you listening to me, dear ladies? That sounds like false doctrine to you? Sorry. It's just the doctrine of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's false doctrine to the feminist movement. It's false doctrine to humanism. It's false doctrine to these things that rage against God's divine order. Yeah, it's true. It's true. It's true. Mambalosta kure bebe bedika tala da bada. I prevedu kura masa tala da bete iti piste kare. Lo mambra dara ste taia. Mambronda vestifika tala da batea. East of Roma Mamonda de Vete de Sete. Ibrava Kutara Nana Manasatila. Ura Baba Manana Sapatigili. Don't worry tonight. Good hygiene in this place. No bacteria can work. Okay, don't worry. Okay? Don't worry about nothing. Okay? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to do things a little different here tonight with communion. I'm going to start communion, and the hacking stops right now in Jesus' name. And even if you touch the bread with that hacking hand, it will have no power to transmit its disease. But if you can please consider not touching the bread with the hacking hand. That's the hand that covered the mouth that hacked. Are you with me? It would be greatly appreciated by all those downline from you. Because what I want to do is I want to hand out the bread, and I just want you to pass it down. I want you to break the bread to the person next to you. Okay? The night that Jesus was betrayed. Think about it. Come on now. The night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, he broke it. He said, this is my body which is broken for you. All man could do really was betray Jesus and forsake him. Just the way it worked. As far as I know, the way I look at things, it's pretty much what Satan did. Judas was a perfect emulation of Satan. He did exactly what Satan, we don't know his name, we just know him by his acts. Did you know that? Really, that your name is really your acts. Did you know that? That everybody in the Bible, their name is their acts. Yahushua, who we call Jesus, means God's salvation. Satan means the accuser or slanderer. Everybody is known. They're named based on their acts. Huh? I am certain, I feel certain, that all Judas did was exactly what Satan, his father, did. His father. Huh? The one who took hold of him. Whether he was ever transformed and ever serious or not, none of us will know till we get there, because the Lord doesn't really tell us a lot about. We have to guess. But we do know that Satan entered into him that day, that night at communion. It's pretty radical, isn't it? The Lord said, don't eat and drink the body unworthy. For this reason, for this cause, because people do not discern in the body of Christ, there is many sicknesses among you. Huh? Isn't that a strange thing for Paul to say? And that many of you sleep, which is a word used concerning those who die. When in that first communion, that typified communion, rather, on the day we call the Exodus, when God brought them out of the land of Israel, read about Exodus chapter 12, every one of them got healed when the bread went in, the lamb. See, the bread represents the lamb. It's his body. He said, this is my body. He's the lamb. He said, this is my body. This is the lamb. We're going to eat lamb tonight. Lamb bread. Amen. Are you with me? Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is my body. His body. He bore my sins in his own body, you see. So that I could be dead to sin. I'm going to discern his body. By his stripes. By his stripes. By his wound, literally. Doesn't really say stripes in the Greek language or the Hebrew language. It says wound. By his wound. He's pierced. He was beaten. He's pierced with the thorns. The best crown that men could give him. To release that healing flow, a spear was thrust through his side. My. I mean, that's really when I started, when you started prophesying there with that, that's when I heard communion tonight, you know. I was actually had it in my spirit earlier. I wanted to do it Sunday, and the Lord didn't allow me. A couple of reasons. Hallelujah. Would you stand praying? If there's anybody you need to forgive, forgive them. Doesn't matter what anybody does to you. Just love them. Doesn't matter what anybody says. Bless them. The Lord showed us how to deal with our enemies. Those who are hostile to us. He tells us to love them. And he tells us how to love them. Bless. Curse not. Huh? We're never into an argument. You're never going to strife. You're never going to see, by help and grace of God, don't get into a posture of defending yourself. You don't need to defend yourself. God's your defense. That's what he demands. Walk with us. We walk in the Spirit. Listen, I've discovered every time I've gone through hard times of being severely persecuted, and we've had the worst dose we've ever had in our life over the past year and a half. The worst dose. From the most unbelievable places. I've discovered that no matter what, say nothing and the anointing will increase. Yeah. Say nothing, bless, and the anointing will increase. Say nothing, bless, love, forgive, and the manifest glory in the presence of God be in your life. Doors will open up before you. Defend yourself, start reacting around, say, talking bad and speaking guile, to invalidate yourself. Not to say that God won't forgive you and show mercy, you're just going to have to wait for your promotion for later until you decide to do what God says to do. Because people think God's going to promote them and bless them when they're doing wrong. He's not going to do that. When you're willing to do it right, then you're going to get everything he's freely given. Period. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Are you willing to do it right? I'm going to do it right. By his help and his grace. I'm going to do it right. You know what you're going to do with that? Just hand it to her, let her break it off so she didn't have to. too much of your grubby hands all over it. I'm just kidding you, man.
My hands are normally grubby, but I understand.
I love Joseph. He just got some seriously dirty hands. No, it's blessed in Jesus' name. You know your name? No bacteria. Did I miss you guys? Did I get the front row? But front row is very special to me. I'm going to have to be honest with you and transparent to you. I love the people on this front row more than I love you. And I hope that's okay with you. And I'm growing in grace. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But I believe that God wants us to love our family above every other person. Our family's first. Do you believe that? Huh? In our earthly relationships, our family's first. If it's not right at home, it can't be right anywhere else. If you can't show love at home, it starts there first, right? Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Well, you're my family too. You go ahead, take that, and you know what you're going to do with it? Yes, man, you're going to do that right on down the road. Just making sure to check it on you. I'm going to kind of break this up. I'm going to give you some here. I'm going to give you some here. That's not a very big piece. I'm going to have to give you another piece. I believe in big chunks. We believe in big chunks around here. Huh? I want you to have some body of Christ and know that you had it. Are you with me? I want you to chew. I want you to be able to chew a couple of times that I just had to swallow. Are you with me? Is that okay? Anybody got a problem with that? Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hokamaka leste. Halamangatana. Shikalamangadea. Hallelujah. With the mighty host I stand. Amen. Did you know that this very precious and sacred to the Father? Person told me, you know, said, well, when you go to the unreached people groups, he said, you really get God's Father's attention. I'm going to tell you right now, there's nothing that gets Father's attention like communion. It's very sacred to Him. It's very sacred to me. It's not common, ordinary. Somebody said, well, you need to be doing it all the time. Well, you need to talk to Father about that. Did we already get you? I just feel like I need to give you more. It's very sacred to me. And, you know, I think it'd be fine, you know, we do it all the time. Everybody just needs to get in the right heart and attitude. And, right disposition. Amen. Praise God. Here you go. You know what you're gonna do with that? I'm just checking. When I see people standing there holding it for too long a time, I'm like, you know, I'm wondering where. I think there's enough to go around there. Is anybody feeling awkward about the bread that's coming your way? Just let me tell you. I was in Papua New Guinea, and I was doing the pastor's conference for the Assemblies of God in Papua New Guinea, and they want and the Lord laid on my heart to have communion. They wanted me to serve communion, and so I told them, I said, you know, just bring me the stuff. They said, we don't have any grape juice. I said, don't worry about it. Don't worry about the grape juice. Don't worry about it. Because I was determined that we were going to have a miracle turn water into wine. I was determined. I felt in my spirit. I had faith for it. The signs and wonders, miracles. That it was radical what was going on. And then they go out of their way and they make this terrible, like, tang stuff, you know, that was dirty water tang juice. Okay? And then they took white bread, and somebody took a lot of pain to ball it up in little balls, and they had dirty, filthy hands. And so the white bread was noticeably at one time white, but it, and now I'm going to have faith in a miracle for something entirely different, that I don't die. It was bad. And the tang, oh, Lord Jesus. I was having a hard time feeling the anointing. It was one of the rough communion. I hope no one feels that way tonight. It's like sometimes when the situation is bad, try to think of something worse. Hallelujah. Kingdom Jaita is Delina. Silata. Silibete. If I get extra cups, yeah, that's right. Just pass them back to the next row. Get more cups than what you need. Just pass straight on back, please. I've never actually done communion like this before. It's a different one. I'm just letting you share in serving communion. Everybody's going to be the altar boys. The ushers. Itala makosihran. There you go. I'm a little drunk. Some of you don't understand that. Scripture says, don't be drunk with wine where it is excess, but be drunk in the Holy Ghost. So I said, well, it doesn't say that. Well, it implies that. What's wrong? For who? Don't you have three there? They have some there?
Sorry.
So I was... Jason's in the spirit, man. He's like, he's got more people than I'm seeing. Got more people with him. Is more that way? More people than I saw. You go. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Is there anybody here? Look around. Is there anybody here tonight that you don't love? That you don't love. Is there anybody here that you don't love with the same love that Jesus loved you? Is there anyone? I want you to look around because there might be someone. And I want you to just be honest and transparent. Is there anybody you don't love? I'm gonna look too. I'm gonna take another look around. I mean, because sometimes in the anointing you don't know anything. I mean, you like don't even know that you ever sinned in your entire life. You can't remember. That's the way the presence of the Lord is. In the presence of the Lord, he doesn't remember any sin. And you're so hooked up with him, you don't remember nothing. You don't remember you haven't done anything wrong. You're going to have to, are you with me?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful?
Yeah.
You get to start feeling and understanding who you are in the context of what he feels and understands that you are. Isn't that beautiful? Have you ever been there? I like staying here. It's a wonderful place to live. There's therefore now no condemnation there. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Pachadestinita. Where did I leave off at? Four more here. Praise God. More? One more? Coming that way. Coming to you. Pass them down. Probably overwhelming you. Always more than you need. Praise the Lord. Man, it's good to see you, buddy. I'm doing good. I'm break that afflicting thing off of you, man. Spirit of affliction, I'm break it off of you. Huh? Are you happy about that?
Yeah, I'm very happy.
Oh, good. We love you very much, man.
Yeah.
And spirit of affliction ain't going to be vacillating no more. Hallelujah. You're going to get healed tonight. Foul thing of torment and hell breaks and broken in Jesus' name. Curse it and dies. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise the name of the Lord. Am I all out of cups? Did you have any more cups? Is there another bag up there, Kelly? Is that it? Because things are going to start happening now, man. We're going to have to start sharing a cup. Just go ahead and find out whoever wants it. Go ahead and take that one all the way back. Communion takes time. I like to take time with communion. Everybody must examine themselves. Right? I like to take time eating the bread. I like to take what Jesus did on the inside of me. That's what happened. The Lamb came in me. Hallelujah. It was the bread of affliction, and it became the bread of liberation. It was the cup of sorrow. It became the cup of joy and rejoicing. Hallelujah. Mongolosaturi. Hallelujah. Ibrababa sisi pita. Mana mane. Mana mana mina ninda bada. Mongadasadeya. You wanted to come and worship the Father, you had to come worship with the Lamb. You want to come step into the realms of divine glory and power like never was been made available for you. You had to bring the goat of the sin offering. Hallelujah. Praise God. And then all the sins of Israel could be dealt with for us for the whole year. So that God could stay there in their midst. Could he remain in their midst. Ula basta para de petela. But this is not provision for a year, but a provision for this life and the life to come, days without end. Oh God, what God has done for us, we must do it for one another. You listen to me. What God has done for us, don't you doubt for one second, we are devoted with everything in our lives to do it for every single man, every woman, every boy, every girl, no one excluded. The only people who are excluded are those who refuse to partake. Those who refuse the communion. They refuse the fellowship. They refuse the agreement. They demand of us to walk another way. We will not. Because if I must choose between you and him, I'm going to go with him. Hallelujah. I pray that is your heart. We will never, by God's grace, make you choose between us and him. Fact of it is, we're going to be with every bit of that the strength that is within us, hollering out, choose him. Follow us and choose him. Choose him. Somebody said, oh, they don't love us. We still here. You left. We still here. What do you mean we don't love you? Maybe you don't love us. Because you left. We're here. Hundreds of people have left this ministry who is never going to leave. Hundreds of people have left this ministry who was never going to leave. And then I somehow, I'm the one, huh? Look. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Communion. Somebody's going to have to lead the way in communion and fellowship. Jesus leading the way. We declaring his word. An argument can never be created by one who proposes an idea, but by the one who rejects it. An argument can never be created by one who proposes an idea, but by the one who rejects it. God has proposed an idea for us. Hallelujah. And I'm not rejecting it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. There's not enough. I was going to just hold out your... I'm going to do this. Geneva, you can help me, or Daniel, you can help me. Let Daniel help me. Geneva, you can help me to get one, because we got four. Start in the back, please. And then Elizabeth, Ruth, Ann, or Ann, which one? Elizabeth, go. I was just waiting for the first one to volunteer. Pretty much what God does. Huh? I've heard many men, I heard Reinhardt say, I wasn't God's first choice. God's first choice didn't go, so he came to me. He said, oh, are you with me? Huh? Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. I was just looking for anybody can use. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. See, it takes a while to have to walk around in this anointing, not stumble and be able to pour straight. Amen. We learn how to stand in the glory. At first, I laid in the glory because I couldn't stand. Then I found some legs, walk around in the anointing. I could stand. First, I couldn't speak in the anointing. I was like that Japanese pastor. I was mute. I have nothing to say. Hallelujah. Then you learn how to speak. God gives you a mouth. He gives you a better mouth than the one you was created with. Praise God. Isn't that wonderful? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Isn't this better than a capillary cup? I mean, a small cup that you have to battle capillary action to be able to drink? Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. What a dog, baby. Praise God. Father, thank you for blessing Jeremiah and Julie's marriage. Praise God for people who want children. Amen. No, I'm telling you. It is amazing how many people are saying we're not having no children. The vow to have children, and then all of a sudden they turn around and we're not having any children. Because the children are going to be a heartache and a mess with the program. Goodness gracious. Told some people recently, the only reason you get married is to have children. What are you talking about? Ain't no other reason to get married. What are you talking about? Goodness gracious. But I'm false doctrine because I believe that. I just got all kinds of false doctrines. Jesus. Enumerate them for me. You know, I'm just happy with that. I'm just happy with that doctrine. And the Lord's made me to understand that he's happy with it too, because he's the one who originated it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Do we have enough juice? Wow. Boy, I am slow. I knew it was going to take me most of the night to get this done. Hallelujah. 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 Man, things about ready to explode now. You better get ready. Hallelujah. This stuff is reality. Huh? This stuff is reality. Hallelujah. This is reality. You say, how can this be reality? A piece of bread representing the body of Jesus, his grape juice representing his very blood. Oh, it's reality. God made it reality. God made this the most real thing that exists in the face of the earth today. A means by which men can be made alive. Those who know Christ Jesus, those who receive this life, are the only ones that are alive. Everyone else is dead. It's the most real thing. And just represents the most real thing. Saw a movie the other night. It had the Shenandoah River in it. Harper's Ferry, West Virginia. About old John Brown. Harper's Ferry, West Virginia. I said, yeah, I've been baptized in the Shenandoah River many times. Because my dad had so many revivals around there, and every time they did baptism, I got baptized again. Because of the glory and presence of God. I'm just a little guy. And that's really something that we're supposed to do once. Because it's like birth, you know, it's just once. But this communion, it's continually. When I stand up there and preach, when I worship the Lord, when I praise Him, I'm drinking the blood. I'm eating the body. I'm having communion. This represents my fellowship. This represents our fellowship with the Lord. Amen. I feel like having the whole jug. Did I miss? Oh. First you're seeing things, then I'm not seeing anything. Is this section? No. We're not going to leave you out. Father, I thank you for your great blessing on Jason and Casey. You know, Jason, Casey, you know something's happening to you tonight. Good thing is happening to you tonight. Good thing is happening. It is wonderful to have a yoke-breaking anointing. An anointing that destroys yokes. Huh? It's wonderful to have the presence of God in our lives that proves everything. Whether it's real or whether it's a lie. Whether it's lasting or whether it's only temporary. Whether it's heavenly or temporal. If it's wood, fire. If it's wood, stubble, and hay, fire burns it up. Some people are crying because the wood, stubble, and hay is all burned up. Man, you don't understand my loss. But if you could look at it right, it's cause to joy and rejoice. Thank you, Jesus. Did you know when Melchizedek, which means king of righteousness, a Tzedek, he's the first Tzedek. In fact, there were many different Tzedeks in that area. It was like pharaohs. He was Tzedeks. There was Avicedek. Avicedek was not a good king. He was an evil king. But Melchizedek, he was a righteous king. And he came and he met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings, where just a few handful of men destroyed the mighty kings of his time. And there Melchizedek met him with the emblems, the bread and the wine, the emblems of redemption, the emblems of how that those sons of Adam should be redeemed from the powers of darkness by the very body and blood of Almighty God. God prepared for himself a body, that by his body and his blood, that his life might become substance for us to live by. Tonight, in the name of Jesus Christ, I break the strongholds of every form of sickness and disease. I break the strongholds of every unholy thing, every unclean thing now, in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you that you bore our sins in the body of your only begotten Son, so that now we, being dead to sin, might live under righteousness. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you took all sickness and disease in your body. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are the true bread, which came down from heaven. If any man eat this bread, shall not die, but shall live forever. Lord, we thank you for such a work of grace that Moses did not give the true manna. But Lord Jesus, you became the true bread, the true manna. Tonight, Lord, we take this that represents your body. And once again, we participate in this wonderful fellowship and communion that was provided for us when the veil of your body was torn in two, like the veil of the temple being rent, so that as we walk
through the bread of your presence. As we walk through your life and your body that was presented there at Calvary, we stand now gazing in the holies of holies, face to face with all boldness before you, Lord. Thank you that no claim can be upon any person's life in this place. I condemn in Jesus' name every accusation of Satan. I rise up and I judge it now. According to your word, Lord. That every power of darkness that would condemn, and every power of darkness that would accuse, and no power. In Jesus' name. That your people in this place will walk in a relationship and an intimacy with you like they've never known. Father, this place will be one bread and will be one cup. Father, that this will be one body. Many members, but one body. In recognition of that which you did for us when you redeemed us in one body. You made us all to drink into one cup. There's not two. Just one. Tonight, Lord, we give ourselves to abiding in you. This life that you've given. Sickness, obey me in Jesus' name. Affliction and disease, out of the body. Depart now. No power of sickness nor disease or affliction will have a right to dominate anyone in this place. That everybody who walks in here, who is sick and afflicted, will be immediately delivered.
Hallelujah.
Satan will have no power.
Amen. You guys almost started to sound like the Church of China just for a minute there. Because they would have been amening me louder than I could even talk with every phrase I just mentioned. I want you to grab a hold of that because there's a confession and there's an agreement that you want to grab a hold of, that you want to have. You do not want to be silent. The days of silence is over. The days of shout is here. The days of proclamation. Yeah. The days of proclamation. The days of holding fast. And professing a Amen. Good confession Amen. Is here. Amen. Hold fast your confession of faith without wavering. For he is faithful who has promised. He's faithful who has promised. He's faithful who has promised. He's faithful who has promised, Daniel. He's faithful who has promised, Anne. He's faithful who has promised, Ruth. He's faithful who has promised, Elizabeth. He's faithful who has promised, Leslie. He's faithful who has promised, Paulina. He's faithful who has promised, Angelo. He's faithful who has promised, Kelly. I could write down the left. Every one of you, your name, insert it there. He's faithful who has promised. Manny. He's faithful who has promised, Teresita. He's faithful who has promised. Everyone, put your name there. Brandon. Kristen, grab a hold of God. Grab a hold of God. Live your life for the kingdom. Live your life for Jesus. If you don't, all will be lost. All will be lost. Tonight, Lord, once again, we devote ourselves to that which you died for us to have. We consecrate our lives to that which you died and suffered and bled for us to have. You endured rejection and humiliation and defamation. Stripped naked for men to gaze upon and wag their head and curse you and spit upon you that we might have this fellowship. Father, we pray that we will count every drop of it, every moment of it, every second of it, the most blessed, glorious thing that we could have ever had. The night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take it and eat it." When that body was broken at Calvary, when it was rent at Calvary, it truly is that place, as Paul said to the Hebrews, that represented the veil. The veil of his flesh that represented the veil of the temple by which, as I partake of it and enjoy it and fellowship with it and walk with him in it, is my entrance in to the Holy of Holies. Amen. Me and John, I'm a good guy now. And it's unleavened. Doesn't have any sin in it. It's unleavened. Hallelujah. Doesn't have any false doctrine in it. Hallelujah. It's unleavened. And the juice is unleavened too. The juice has no alcohol in it. It's totally unleavened. Totally unleavened. There's no alcohol in it. It's totally unleavened. It's Yitzra. It's not iron. It's Yitzra. It's totally unleavened. Today, the church walks around with a cup of judgment in their hand, laughing, saying, "We can drink alcohol. Oh, you have false doctrine because you're telling us we can't drink alcohol." A preacher's telling me, comes and tries to chastise me and tells me that I'm not preaching the Bible because I'm telling people that can't drink alcohol. I say that look in the Bible, look in the Old Testament, you'll discover that you're prophesying against yourself. You're walking around with a cup of iron in your hand, which is the cup of judgment. Go read again. This is Yitzra, unleavened juice, Yitzra. Forgive me for spitting. But it's a very important point that I need to make. It's Yitzra. It's unleavened juice. There's no leaven in it. It's not iron with alcohol content. It's Yitzra. Here it is. It's Yitzra. I'm going to keep the feast with unleavened. Amen. Amen. Purge out therefore the leaven. That's what Paul said. And be a holy lump. A holy lump. A holy lump. Somebody said, but if we're gonna be popular, if we're gonna be able to do more things, and we're gonna have to do these compromises. No, God has no compromise. Somebody said, "Oh, you must compromise." No, no, that is satanic. Compromise is what Satan tries to get us to do. To compromise. God demands agreement. Agreement. God has nothing to say or do with compromise. Nowhere ever is it the doctrine of God. People have been so misled, it just as though it's almost that every truth is false doctrine. Tonight we keep this with unleavened between ourselves, between him and us. Because if we're not one with him, if we're not feeling his presence and interacting with him, we can never be one with each other. You can never enter into the oneness of the body. The oneness and the agreement of the body of Christ until you're one with him. Yeah. That's the only place oneness comes from. That's it. People trying to be one with another. One with another. And one with one another and fit in. Won't work. You need to come to a place of union. Enjoy in his presence. Yeah. Interacting with him. Having the atmosphere of his glory. Because I'm going to tell you right now. Let me tell you this. There's nothing so wonderful. There's nothing that defines life other than being in his presence. Only his presence defines holiness. Outside of his presence, there is none. Only his presence defines righteousness. Outside of it, there is none. Yeah. And you can't tell me that you're too busy for life. Can't tell me that. I'm still eating my bread. We want you to have enough fellowship to know that you've had some. Are you with me? Yeah. Can I say that again? Should I say that again? We want you to know that you've had enough. We want you to have enough fellowship to know that you've had some. After that they had supped, he took the cup. And he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood by which your sins are erased." Erased. Erased. Not covered. Erased. Yeah. Erased. He did not say covered. He said erased. Yeah. I'm going to discern his body tonight. I'm going to recognize what his blood has done for me. I'm going to be in the faith. erased. Unto him who loved us and loosed us from our sins in his own blood and has made us priests and kings. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your precious blood.
Amen. Mana esho palatoya, yebi mana mata e pahala, zita arahatoya, inna napohuya. Hallelujah. Zoti adatata, mandala sipakaloma, mandalo sipikele de bere, mandala pikete herasi, blermo sitrede, blermo mumine, zatmine neke. Hallelujah. 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 Ooh, ooh. Thank you, Jesus. Ah, mom, yitzra, malasutai.
Sweet, klakto, sweet. Not bitter, not sour, sweet. Mambrubata, not the sour cup, not the bitter cup. Mambrubata, ishte. Mmm, sweet, sweet cup. Luramamamam, herimahata, sititi, latoha. Sweet, not the cup where all the sweet's been ed up, but the cup where the sweet dominates. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Not the cup where the sugar's been turned to ethanol. Sweet cup. Of redemption, of rejoicing. Mama. The sacrifice of his blood. The blood that Abel's offering testified of. Yes. That blood that was poured out at Calvary. The red blood of Jesus that breaks the power of every power unlike God. Yes. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Well, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Say it, Almighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Oh, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout to God with a voice of triumph. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, mighty God, the souls of men, Lord, we cry out for the souls of San Diego. Lord, we cry out for the souls of this nation.
Father, we ask you, pour out your glory, pour out your fire, pour out your blood, pour out your water upon this place, oh God, through us. Through us, Lord, like a mighty river. Woohoo! Father, we ask you, Lord of the harvest, that you raise up laborers and let those laborers be us. May they be many and not a few, oh God, we pray in Jesus' name. Use us, oh God, take our lives to glorify the only begotten Son, Christ Jesus. Father, we thank you for the anointing right now that breaks off every yoke. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Membrana satana na mani. Membrana na masana na manena. Manangadana da bosoro babota. Just with your hands lifted up, I just want you to stand here in the presence of the Lord with me. Let him touch you. Let him overwhelm you. Hallelujah. Papa has purposed an encounter for you with his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. By that working power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost that you placed upon my son Daniel. That nothing is going to be able to stop it. No power of darkness, no assignment from hell, no lies of the enemy, no persecution of Satan, no rejection of men. Father, we thank you that he chose you. He's choosing you. No matter all the turmoil, the struggle. Father, we thank you that nothing can stand in his way. Father, we thank you for all your people stand around. Those that are in the midst of the battle. Those that are in the midst of conflict. And we come wherever there's two, put 1,000 to flight. Where there's 1,000, where there's two, there's 10,000. Where there's two, there's 10,000. That's a mess. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want you to lift your hands towards heaven. I just want you to receive right now the things that God has for you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want you to come and worship the Lord with your offering. I know that most of you have already blessed the Lord with your tithe. Won't you come worship the Lord with your offering while we're just singing? I
Hallelujah. 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 Dear people, we love you so very much. We praise God that you're standing with us. This Saturday, we got a lot of things going on, so if you could come and help us, it would be a blessing. Got some works we got to get done around here. And we want you to be encouraged. We want you to start flowing in the gifts of the Spirit like never before. We want you to know that there's an open opportunity. There's an open mic for the sound of heaven to be heard through your voice. Amen? It's always here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So I want you to stir yourself up in these things. Amen. Adam, you got something strong on yourself, right? You're just there? That's good. That's good. Just want to make sure. I want every one of you to be bold. God gives you something. It's a fire on the inside of you. I want you to come shout it. Come move in it. God lays on, Holy Ghost lays upon your heart. Somebody's sick. I want you to come move in it. God gives you a tongue, an interpretation tongue. I want you to feel free to move in it. Start participating with God like never before. And watch what happens. The growth and the maturity that God, the Holy Spirit, desires to manifest through your life will change this world around us. We'll shake this earth again with the power of the living God, His glorious church. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need. Find a bunch of people, hug them, bless them, tell them that you love them.
Every hour, I need you. Oh, Lord, my one defense, my Lord, I